Hi, welcome back to this, my fifth data update for 2023. Now, in my previous post about 2022, I noted that it was a return to normalcy year. Interest rates reverted back to where they were pre-2008, and risk capital discovered there was a downside risk in addition to being an upside. And during the course of the year, investors rediscovered, as they have hundreds of times before, that the end game for a business is not just to grow revenues or add users, but to actually make money. In this post, I'd like to focus on how 2022 played out on that front. What happened to the profitability at companies? How did the increase in inflation play out in the profitability of companies? Were some sectors worse hit than others? The profit effects vary across geographies. So let me focus in on just profits in this session. And to do that, I want to start by perhaps insulting some of you and redefining profit measures to make sure we're talking about the same thing. As you know, I've done a short session on accounting because I see a lot of confusion when people talk about profits, and investors and managers sometimes use that confusion to their advantage. So if you look at an income statement for a non-financial service company, here's how I see profitability play out. You got revenues minus cost of goods sold gives you gross profit. Gross profit is perhaps the most generous measure of profitability you can come up with. It does give you useful information about the unit economics of a business. Businesses with very solid unit economics, and by unit economics I'm talking about how much it costs you to produce that extra unit you sell, will tend to have higher gross margins. From your gross profit, you're going to subtract out other operating expenses. These are expenses that are more fixed, might not be directly connected to your units sold. It could include things like SG&A and R&D. Not R&D because it's not an operating expense, but other operating expenses which are fixed but which you need to do your operations. You subtract those operating expenses from gross profit, you end up with operating profit. Operating profit is a measure of what your business generated as profits, as opposed to just the equity. Once you subtract out any interest expenses from it, and perhaps add interest income from cash, and also bring in income from non-operating assets, cross-holdings in other companies, you end up with pre-tax profit. You pay taxes on that, you end up with net profit. Gross profit, operating profit, pre-tax profit, and net profit. You can already see that depending on the story I tell about a company and I want to spin that story, I'm going to use a different measure of profitability to back it up. Now let me start with the graph that should be obvious, but it's good to see the numbers anyway. It's easier for a company to be money-making on a gross profit basis than an operating profit basis, and easier to make money on an operating profit basis than a net profit basis. As I said, that was pretty obvious. And if you look across all publicly traded companies in 2022, that's exactly what you see. I've broken the companies down by sector, and every sector, close to 85-90% of companies, perhaps even higher, have positive gross profits. Only a subset of those have positive operating profits. And in fact, the percentage, the number of companies with, you know, positive operating profits and net profits are pretty close. Now, there's some sectors where the drop-off is more drastic. Absolutely. If you look at healthcare, much bigger drop-off from gross profits, the percentage of companies making gross profits, the percentage of companies making positive operating or net profits. You can already see why when we talk about profitability, we have to be specific about which profit measure. Now, this looks at the percentage of companies which are money-making on each of these dimensions. Let's look at the dollar values. What I've done in this table is aggregated the revenues, the gross profit, the operating profit, and the net profit of every publicly traded company at the start of 2023, broken it down by sectors. If you look at each sector, you can see that as you go from gross profit to operating profit, you lose a hefty chunk of your profits. Collectively, across all companies globally, the gross profits were $16.9 billion. But the operating profit was only $6.4 billion. And as you go from operating profit to net profit, another drop-off of close to $2.2 billion. You're saying, what's going on with financial services? It's the one sector where gross and operating profit have no meaning, so I've gone directly to net profit. So these are all dollar values. You can already see a pattern start to play out depending on how far down the income statement you come to measure profits. The problem with dollar profits is comparing dollar profits across companies is tough to do, often meaningless. Bigger companies will have larger dollar profits. So through business history, we've tried to scale profits to something. The first thing you can scale profits to is revenues. When you scale profits to revenues, you get margins. I've taken gross profit, scaled to revenues, come up with gross margins, operating profit divided by sales to come up with operating margins, and net profit divided by sales to get net margin. I've also given you two offshoots. In the first one, I act like I'm taxed on the operating income. Keyword is act. I don't get taxed on operating income, but I act like I do. And then look at what I'd have been left with is after-tax operating income. Come up with an after-tax operating margin. The other tangent is to take operating income and add depreciation and amortization. Operating income and EBIT are concepts that roughly measure the same thing. EBIT plus DA gives me EBITDA. It's an EBITDA margin. Technically a cash flow margin, not an earnings margin, but still swimming in the same pool. You can already see that depending on which margin you look at, you're going to get a very different number. I've cautioned people that when they're talking to a company, the CFO keeps talking about how good the gross margin is of the company. It's probably because the other margins don't look that great. I mean, gross margins are often the fallback for companies that haven't figured out a way to make a bottom line profit. So let's look at how the world varies on gross margins. So this is a graph focused just on gross margins. I've taken every non-financial service company in the world and put up in a distribution. The median gross margin globally for all companies, across all companies, about 30%. I've also listed the 25th and the 75th percentile. So you can see there's variation from 16 to 50%. There are differences across different parts of the world. Australia and New Zealand seem to have the highest gross margin companies, perhaps because they have a significant percentage of natural resource companies. The country or the region with the lowest gross margins, China. And so while people talk about the growth in China, it's worth noting that the gross margins tend to be lower. Now, some of it is due to different sectors. I pointed to the fact that Australia and New Zealand have natural resource companies. China has more manufacturing companies. So variations in business mix can explain these differences in gross margin. So to examine what type of business you're in can affect your gross margin, I decided to look across industries. And for those of you who track my data, I break down all companies into 95 different industry groups. And in this table, I've listed the 10 groups with the highest margins. Actually, it should be the lowest margins on top, and the 10 groups with the highest margins at the bottom. So if you look at the lowest margins, you can see that you have a motley crew of companies, right? You've got retail, disproportionately, there are three retail. Retail businesses tend to have low margins, operating in gross, and it shows up in the numbers. Okay? You've got a couple of young businesses, online software, for instance, or internet software, as it's classified here. And you have a couple of old-time businesses that are struggling, power, airlines. Those are the industry groups with the lowest margins. If you look at the industry groups with the highest margins, you see a lot of oil and gas companies. Tobacco is always up there. A couple of more advanced technology businesses, software is there, and semiconductors. So these are businesses with low and high margins, and you can already see that depending on the sector you enter, you're going to enter a very different set of rules in terms of what kind of margins you can get in that sector. So that's one way to scale profits to revenues. Here's the other. You can scale profits to how much is invested in a business. And you measure investment. This is the only place in finance we do this. We measure investment looking at what's on the books in terms of book value. Now, if you want an equity-focused measure of returns, you can divide net income by book value of equity to come up with return on equity. If you're looking at what all capital providers in a company are making, you take operating income and divide by not just book value of equity, but book value of equity plus book value of debt minus cash, invested capital. You can already see that return invested capital measures returns to all claim holders. Return equity focuses just on equity investors. With that lead in, though, I do understand that return on capital has become this magic bullet that some consultants and investors use to find companies. And there are a few people who use return on invested capital in very sensible ways to explore business economics. My good friend Mike Mabuson, you know, has written incredibly good things on return invested capital. And I'd strongly suggest you read some of his works because he ties return on capital to the quality of a business and the value of growth. But I do have to tell you that return on invested capital has flaws. The flaws come from the fact that both the numerator and the denominator are accounting numbers. And because they're accounting numbers, accounting inconsistencies, accounting choices can affect your return on capital. I've written extensively about how accounting misclassifications of R&D and leases throw off your return on capital. I've also talked about how items like restructuring charges and goodwill can throw off your return on invested capital. With all that said, though, I think there is value to computing this number for companies, and I do it for all publicly traded companies. A little bit about the mechanics of what I do. To get my return on capital, I do capitalize R&D. I do this across companies, and I bring it into book value, which increases my invested capital for technology companies, pharmaceutical companies. So my book equity and invested capital is going to look different than the numbers accountants are going to report for those companies. I've been capitalizing leases, treating them as part of debt for 30 years, starting in 2019, at least in some parts of the world, IFRS and GAAP controlled, leases are treated as debt. So I compute the return invested capital using the trailing 12-month numbers. And that's an Achilles heel. I agree with it. It's a weakness because numbers can go up and down. And using the effective tax rate in the most recent 12 months in the numerator and using my book value of debt, including leases, book value of equity, including R&D. And I do also net out goodwill because I think I need to get a measure of how much is invested in capital invested in existing assets, and goodwill in a sense is premium you're paying for future growth. It's a debatable issue, but I wanted to keep things simple. I compute this return invested capital for every single publicly traded company, non-financial service company. We'll come back and talk about how I use it, but if you look at the distribution of return invested capital at the start of 2023, you get a very interesting mix of returns on capital. First, the median return on capital for a global company is 5.19%. That's not very good. Median return on capital for U.S. companies is 7.44%, a little better. But it's also a distribution with outliers in both sides. Notice the percentage of companies with returns on capital that exceed, in this case, 30% in one extreme, and are less than minus 50% at the other. This is a distribution that has clearly outliers in both directions. And, you know, it's worth examining what those outliers tell us. But before I do that, I want to introduce an intermediate measure. Now, when you look at return on invested capital, the 5.44, this 5.19 or the 7.44%. Now, part of you are saying, that's good, right? They're making money. They are. But remember, making money is not enough, because you have to make enough money to cover what you could have earned on the capital invested in this business elsewhere. That's what you're trying to estimate with the cost of capital or cost of equity. I won't bore you with how I do it because I already went through that process in data updates 2 and 3. But cost of equity is the opportunity cost of taking what you've invested in a company and investing it elsewhere in a project of equivalent risk. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to take the return on equity and compare it to the cost of equity. Take that difference, you get a measure of excess returns to equity investors. Take the return on capital compared to the cost of capital. It's going to give me a measure of excess returns to all capital providers. Now, obviously, I want my companies to earn more than it costs to fund those companies. My return on equity to exceed the cost of equity, my return on capital to exceed the cost of capital. Now, do you think most companies earn more than their cost of equity and capital? Been reading the stories about rapacious companies that charge these prices that are sky high and rip the consumers off and make huge profits, you would think that most companies earn well above their cost of capital and cost of equity, right? You could do that, but you'd be wrong. Here's a table that shows you the state of the world in terms of excess returns broken down by geography. So here's what I've essentially computed. The return on equity versus cost of equity, return on capital versus cost of capital for every company. I also reported the percentage of companies where that spread is positive. Remember, you want this to be positive for every company. You earn more than your cost of equity or cost of capital. Take a look at the bottom line. If you look at all global companies, about 30% of companies earned returns on equity that exceeded the cost of equity. About 31% earned returns on capital that were more than their cost of capital. Put simply, about 60% of companies had trouble making their costs of funding. Now, it could come up with excuses. Maybe these are young companies working their way to a better profit future. Maybe they had a bad year. Something happened in that country or that sector. But this is a statistic that over the last decade has always tilted in favor of companies not being able to earn their cost of capital. I'll come back and talk about how this statistic might have compared to what it was last year. But about 70% of companies are having trouble making the cost of equity or the cost of capital. Again, I decided to look across industry groups to see which were the best and the worst industry groups, at least when it came to these excess returns. I'm using return capital to cost of capital as my base for this ranking. So take a look at the 10 worst performing industry groups and the 10 best performing industry groups in terms of excess returns measured as return on capital minus cost of capital. If you look at the best performing group, it's like an ESG advocate's nightmare, right? You've got fossil fuel companies in abundance. You got tobacco in there. You got soft beverages. That's the Coca-Cola's of the world selling sugar drinks. You might not like those businesses from a morality standpoint, but they're incredibly profitable businesses. If you look at the industry groups with the most negative excess returns, it's really a mix of what young industry groups, or software again shows up, groups that have been disrupted and are in trouble, airlines, in this case, auto parts, auto and truck, the electric car business has disrupted it. And some old-time businesses that have fallen on hard times, power, real estate operations. My point is not that be very careful. I'm not suggesting that the industry groups with the most positive excess returns are going to be good investments, because that depends on how they're priced. But there are clearly differences across industry groups in terms of how well or badly these groups do in being able to earn returns that exceed their cost of capital. So what's the bottom line? I'll go back to my start of the session. I said this was a year where we got reminded that you start a business, you better figure out a pathway to making money. You can't just go for growth, and more growth. And that's a healthy reaffirmation. Second, this was also a year where, if you think about the game here for value creation is earning more than your cost of capital, this was a year where that game became much more difficult to play. Why? Because I think, I've looked back over the last 63 years, the year when my estimated cost of capital jumped the most across the board for both US and global companies. So to give you some perspective, cost of capital at the start of 2022 for US companies was 5.6%. That was the median. By the end of the year, it was 9.63%. For global companies, it went from 6 to 10.3%. Remember that company that had a median 7.44% return on capital in the US? Start of 2022, that company was riding high. It was earning more than its cost of capital. The end of 2022, if it hadn't fixed its return on capital, it was delivering less than its cost of capital. So the way I see it is, if you look at 2022, there are lots of companies that started the year thinking that they had good investments in the books and ended the year realizing those investments are not that good. Now, I'm not going to pick on these companies. It's not fair to ask people to make decisions based on things they couldn't see. But buyer's remorse and looking back and saying, I wish I hadn't done that, is not going to get your money back. The only thing you can do is stop adding to the damage. If your hurdle rate is stuck in what you've been using 2, 3, 4 years ago, it's time to revisit that hurdle rate, make it more realistic. So if your 7% hurdle rate, you move it to 10%, at least stop taking bad investments to add to the pile you already have. I hope you found the session useful. Thank you very much for listening.